years. So how it is being used in the industry and how does it compare with other tools? We will make sure today that you have R installed and you know how to install R in your system, you are able to install the packages, and that you are able to do some basic operations in R. So you will get familiar with the R platform. And there is also R Studio, which I will be introducing you to, and that's I find it a little more intuitive to use than R itself. So you will have an option of using R or R Studio. I will introduce you to both. R has a very extensive help, and this is something which we all need to be very comfortable using, because no matter how many courses or how many years you spend in R, R is an evolving language. New packages are being evolved every day. New functions are getting created. So you need to rely on the help to find out what are the packages, what are the functions which you can use for your modeling. And help comes to a lot of help in that matter. So we will look into how to use the help. And of course, we will get familiar with the different communities, the different groups where you can also reach out for help. So what is business analytics? So if I look at the definition which is provided here, it tells me study of business data using statistical techniques and programming for creating decision support and insights for achieving business goals. But if you look at this definition in parts, one is it involves study of data and business data. So we all understand that. Statistics and programming, this is very important, right? So, you need to understand statistics as well as programming. So nowadays there is so many tools and programs and methods available to do statistical work. But if you are not a programmer, if you don't know the basics of programming, probably you can't use this to the best of its potential, right? So that is where statisticians with no programming experience do feel a certain handicap in the area of business analytics, and the same goes with programmers who have no statistical technique in the statistical background. So though you may know how to program, you may know how to call the functions, you feel handicapped by your basic understanding of statistics, and I'll go into why that is very, very critical. So these two things, the statistics and the programming, goes hand in hand. For creating decision support, right, so whether you do prediction or you do optimization or you do some, exploratory analysis, what we are really doing is creating decision support. So in business, every day you have to take decisions. And for all these years, a lot of these decisions one used to take by, you can call it intuition, experience, discussions among various people with the expertise and the skills. It will have an exact science. So why today? Why suddenly are we talking about data-driven decisions? Yeah, so that is the question. So the world is now moving towards a stage where these decisions are more and more taken with the support of data. Because no matter how experienced, how much knowledgeable you are, intuition may always be wrong. There is a lot of thrust, there is a lot of focus that we want to take decisions which is supported by data. And why today? Because of a number of reasons. One is a lot of data is available today. And you are aware of that, right? There is a lot more data which is being collected today all over in every domain. And the ability to work with that data. So IT infrastructure with cloud computing, with the data centers, today there is a support for you to work with a huge volume of data. And thirdly, there is so much of tools. Like, you know, so a few years ago it was probably just a few tools which people had to depend on. Today there are so many tools in the market which makes it possible for you to easily start using data for your business problems or business issues. So that is where we say that business analytics plays a role in helping you take decisions or decision support and insights for achieving business goals. And this is also very important. What is the purpose? What is the purpose of all this modeling? What is the purpose of all this collecting data, running so many models? So never to lose sight of the goal. And this is where domain knowledge plays a big role. You know, sometimes, you know, I'm thinking of an example here. So when I just started, when I started doing my analysis career, so we were doing some analysis of crimes data. You know, what kind of crimes over the last 4-5 years in a particular city in the States. We were analyzing the different crimes, the different types of crimes, at what time of day it was happening, and you know, all that. And we did a lot of things. We did clustering, we did segmentation, we did different kinds of modeling. And, you know, we made a presentation where some of the insights were like, okay, theft of vehicles happen outdoors while burglary happens indoors. And, you know, this we found out after doing a lot of analysis. And this is like really common sense, right? Of course, vehicles happen outdoor and burglary happen indoor. There's really no analysis which you need to do to come up with that understanding. Yeah, so sometimes you get so involved in the process that you lose sight of what is your goal, what is your goal, what is your purpose of doing all this analysis. So that is where your domain knowledge, your having a domain expert in your team on board is very important, who can always keep the focus in place. Okay. Okay, now coming back to who uses it, almost everyone. Today, all industries, anywhere you look at, there is definitely a potential and a chance for using data. And the domains who are like using it rampantly, these are a few of the domains where it is very popular: banking and financial services, pharma, healthcare, life sciences. That is another area where there is a huge amount of data generated every day. India, probably we are still, you know, evolving in the sense, even at the data collection phase, we need to get to that stage where we are able to collect the data which we need in the pharma and the healthcare space. But in US and all, definitely there is a where everything, you know, with EMRs, electrical medical records, and EHRs, there is a huge scope of capturing this data and analyzing it. Telecom and retail are two other domains where a lot of this data is being used. Okay, so moving on. These are the different domains where we describe that, you know, business analytics is used very commonly. So who creates it? Who does the analytics? Who creates the models? And what are the skills needed? So let us look into that. Okay. So before we go into business analytics and who does that, what is business intelligence? So this whole space, I would say that business analytics is a part of business intelligence, the subset of business intelligence. Business intelligence is this whole area which starts with collecting the data, you know, extracting that data. So by all these years, by business intelligence, we used to understand data warehousing or, you know, what is it? So collecting data from discrete systems, bringing it together, creating reports, drilling down into the data. And then the analytics involved around it, you know, model building, prediction, everything is business intelligence. And data analytics forms a part of it. So like you see in this diagram here, there is data warehousing, enterprise reporting, performance management, and data mining. Business analytics falls more into the area of data mining here. So it's a set of theories, methods, processes, architectures, and technologies that transform data for business purposes. And here we look into what is data science. So in the slide previous to this, we were talking about what are the skills required for a business analyst, right? And we already mentioned that it's kind of a mixture of different kind of skills. So today, to be a good data scientist, you need to know programming. At least maybe you don't need to be an exceptional programmer, but you absolutely need to know the basics and fundamentals of programming. Because not every time, whatever package or model you use, you can just use it off the shelf. You need to, you know, be able to make your own changes to the code, if necessary, to you know, create your own model. So a lot of times your, and also for data manipulation, for data imputation, a lot of programming skills are often required, right? So you need to have the basics or fundamentals of programming you need to know. Then of course you need to know statistics and you need to know the business. So if you look at the Conway's diagram here, it's a very interesting Venn diagram which tells us that how these three skills or these three areas which we are talking about correlate, and how data scientists, to be a good data scientist, you really need to fall in that small space where you have knowledge of all three. So let's say you're very good at programming and you have knowledge of maths, but you don't, or stats, but you don't have domain knowledge. So you may come up with a lot of models and machine learning techniques, etc., but they really may not give that value to the business. The end of it, what do you want to do? You want to derive insights for business, right? So that is the space where machine learning, if you see on top, hacking skills and maths and statistics knowledge, they overlap, but there is no domain knowledge. So you become a very good machine learning expert, but not necessarily a data scientist. Then if you are very good at programming and you have domain knowledge, but you don't know maths. Now see, if you see this, say it's a danger zone, because there are a lot of people who we see in the industry today who probably are, because of all the tools like R and SAS and different packages which are available, and because they know programming, you can just, you know, easily call for, run a regression model or run any complex algorithm without really knowing what is happening inside it. And that is very critical, you know. If you do that, you will get results. The software will make sure you get results and you might feel very happy about it. But unless you know what the model is doing and whether that's the right model to use, whether that's the right parameter to use, you will get results which really are not correct or really are not, will not tell you what you need to know. So that's the danger zone. Right? You have to be very careful that the statistical methods you are using can actually be applied. Whatever are the, you know, criteria for, let's say, you know, today you want to use a regression model. And there are certain prerequisites. Just to use this model, your data has to fill these conditions. You know? But, and that's what statistics tell you. The science of statistics tell you that if you want to, you know, use this model, you have to make sure that you have at least, let's say, 1,000 data points. That's your simple prerequisite, that, like that. You know, the number of data points has to be at least 1,000. Otherwise, you can't use this model. So let's say I don't have 1,000, but I feel that, you know, doesn't matter. Let me use the model anyway and see what results I get. And I use the model and I get a very nice looking result. And I feel, oh, cool, it doesn't matter. What if I don't have 1,000 data points? It's still working. But then you have broken the premise on which the model is based, right? So you have to make sure that whatever statistical, you know, fundamentals are there, you are adhering to that. And the software can't make sure that you do that. That is where your knowledge of statistics comes in. And the other area is stats knowledge and domain knowledge, but no programming. And that's how traditionally people have done data analysis, right? It's only in the recent years that a lot of programming is involved in data science, because we are working with more and more data. We are talking about speeds which are, you know, almost real time at times when you need to run a model. Like, you are all aware of this. Let's say you go to a website, like you go to Amazon.com and you order a book, and immediately you see 3-4 recommendations, right? That you want to buy this book, people have also bought that book, which means even while you are buying, there was some algorithm running at the background which was trying to figure out what are the kind of books that you might want to, might be interested in, and throwing out the result in real time, right? Programming is important. Yeah, you can't do that with your traditional approach. Yeah, so that is where statistics and programming comes together. So all these skills together build a data scientist, and which is why it is, you know, even though there are so many people who are trained in stats or maybe programming, it is difficult to get that right mix, and there is so much of a demand for a good data scientist. Yeah. Alright, so I'm just trying to open this link. So if you open this link here, right, so you can go and play with this link, this data scientist, that Venn diagram which I'm talking about. So it's a very nice you know, Venn diagram, and as you spend more time with it and read through it, you know, you really understand what this is talking about. So business analytics, our course is designed around both these areas. One is business analytics, where we don't lose focus of what is the requirement, what is the business need which we are trying to address. Yeah, and data science, where we'll primarily use R for all our data science activities. Some programming skills, of course, we will not be going into deep programming, but we will be writing some small code in R. And we will apply some statistical methods. We will not go into a lot of statistical theory, but you know, I'll encourage you to do that on your own. Understand the theory behind each of the techniques which we apply. And if you have any specific questions about any statistical theory, please send me an email and we can take it offline. We may not have the time to go into the statistical theory in the course itself, but I'll be happy to address any questions which you might have. We will try to look at how these methods are used specific to certain domains, and which is why I was asking you what kind of domain knowledge which you have. So you can bring in your own expertise, you know, even though you know, this course primarily I'm talking and you are listening, I'll be happy to learn from you and get your experience and inputs so that everyone can benefit from that. All right. Okay. Okay, so what will we learn in this course? We will do some data visualization, and that is one of the, you know, one of the very positives or advantages of using R. You know, you can very easily do okay, I think I moved one more slide. You can very easily do some very good visualizations and all with little or no programming. Yeah. Some of the standard data mining techniques which you may be aware of, clustering, association analysis, can be easily done in R. There are packages which enable you to do that. So we will look into that. Maybe a bit later in the program, after the first couple of weeks, we will look into how we can do clustering, how we can do association analysis. Anyone knows what is association analysis, what is clustering? Are you aware of these terms? Clustering I know, but not association analysis. Okay, Rahul. Yeah, forming groups, Shalini, that's basically what clustering is. Okay, so clustering, which you, as you, some of you mentioned, yeah, association linking, right? So what I gave you that example, that is a kind of association, right? So if you go and buy something today online, then you know, you find some the website recommending to you that why don't you also look at these products? Yeah, you're familiar with that, right? So that is a kind of association. Association analysis, where based on your profile, based on your pattern of buying, you link needed for pen, ink needed for pen. Yeah, yeah, exactly. You're perfectly correct. So if you go and buy a pen, you might, you know, there's a huge possibility that you might also need ink, right? So the shopkeeper knows you have bought a pen. So yeah, Shushant has given us an example. So that's a good example, yeah. So you go and buy a pen. So immediately, if it's an online, you see that, you know, a promotion on buying ink, or at least it comes on your list of recommendations, right? So this is something which is even done in your, you know, regular kirana stores, right? Today we are just putting these concepts and using data to do it. But exactly, if you go to your local store and you buy a cricket bat, then you know the shopkeeper will ask you, do you need a ball? Or if you go and buy and you must have heard of the famous stories, you know, some through data analysis, some really, you know, these are obvious, right? If you buy a bat, you might need a ball. If you buy a pen, you might need an ink. But what association analysis does, and this is where the role of data analysis come in, which is not clear. There are so many associations which are not clear, but data tells us, right? You must have heard about the beer and diaper story. Yes? How many of you have heard about the beer and diaper story? You've heard. Right. Walmart case study, right? Yeah. Shiv Kumar has not heard. Yeah. So it was a very famous analysis where they did a lot of association analysis and saw. Okay, so why do you do association analysis? So if you know that product A will go with product B, then you can put them together maybe, you know, or give a promotion on the next product maybe, you know, so increase sales. So Walmart came up, Walmart has been one of the pioneers of using data analytics, you know, and they have really been able to use it to increase their business. So one of the things which they found apparently was that on Friday evenings, two products which are very strongly associated or which go very closely together is diapers, you know, baby diapers and beer, which, you know, is something which will not come intuitively to a shopkeeper or anyone, right? Why would beers and diapers go together? Yeah, so like on retrospect it was assumed, or didn't there was some kind of an explanation given that on Friday evenings when the guys are coming back home, you know, they pick up diapers for the kids and you like for their children at home, and when they pick up the diapers, they automatically also pick up a beer bottle. So I don't know whether it's true or false, but apparently this was one of the famous studies where association analysis came up with a really uncommon association, yeah, and which helped give an insight to the customer, the business, that okay, you know, these are two products which we did not realize goes together, but they do go together, yeah. So that is association analysis. Clustering, like all of you have said and like you already know, is a way of grouping. So like customer segmentation, right? You want to know how many of your customers are similar in nature, so that you can give the same kind of promotion, same kind of offers to customers in that same group. Yeah, so it's not a straightforward thing because there are a lot of parameters which you take into consideration. Yeah, and so it may be the age of the customer, the demographics, the location, the income profile, the past purchase history, the sex of the customer. So all these things might come together, and there are advanced data mining or data analytic techniques which take all these different factors and dimensions into consideration and create groups. So that is clustering. clustering. Similarly, there is regression modeling. Now I'm looking at the chat window. They get the babysitter ready before they go out for party, and babysitter asks these first. Asks what first, Shushan? The diaper. Yeah. What about the beer bottle? So yes, so you can come up with your own, right, the need for themselves. So the babysitter says, go and get the diapers, and you pick up a beer bottle for yourself. So there are all kinds of, see, once the data has given you an insight, then you use your knowledge of business. You use your domain knowledge to figure out, does this really make sense? You know, does it make sense that, okay, if diapers and beer bottles go together? So, little bit of your domain knowledge or your insight, like Shushant is thinking, you know, maybe the babysitter has said that, and that is why it might make sense. Let me try it out, yeah? So, business needs to use their own domain knowledge on top of the results which, you know, which the data tells you, right? Yeah. What about modeling or regression? Any idea what is regression? Anyone? Why do we do regression? Have you heard about this term? Past data study, yes. Trend and pattern, okay. Yeah, so basically you are correct. Yeah, regression may be used to predict. But it is used to predict, in fact, but the what regression really does is you want to build a relationship between one variable or one parameter and other parameters, right? Let's say property prices. You can look at it as a simple thing, right? So today you have property, you want to buy a house. Let's say you want to so you want to buy a property, and there are you will be given a price, right? Now this price depends on a number of factors, yeah, of course the size of the house, the area, the location where you're buying the house, the different facilities which are there in the house, whether there's a club, there's a swimming pool, there's a security, yeah, so there are many factors on which this price of your house might depend on, and there is no direct relationship. You know, you can't just give very nicely or easily an equation which will tell you that, okay, this is how they're related, right? And so regression is basically creating a model or creating a explanation where you can give these as inputs, all these parameters, and it will give you the output, which is the price of a house. And of course, if you go into the theory, you know how this is done. There is linear regression. There are different regression models like, you know, stepwise regression, logistic regression. But basically, that is what it is. There are a number of input variables and there is an output variables. You want to be able to create some kind of a relationship between them. And once you have the relationship, you can use this relationship to predict prices for houses where you don't know the price, right? So you give all the input parameters, it will give you a result. So that is why it is also used to predict. It is not used to predict relationship between variables, Shiv Kumar. Maybe I would not use that phrase. It is used to predict the result from the input variables. Yeah? And it builds a relationship based on the data. Demand forecasting, yeah, so just like you have regression, there is forecasting where, you know, forecasting is typically used for predicting the future based on historical data, yeah. So you know the sales for a retail store or for your, you know the sales over a period, over 5 years, over 10 years. You can sort of forecast that, okay, next year I think this is how my sales are going to be. So there will be some increase, there will be some seasonality, you know, certain months, maybe before your Christmas and before your Diwali, there will be a lot more sales. So you factor all these things around in trend and seasonality, and you can forecast. Yeah. Data manipulation, we will look into data manipulation, which is what I was talking about, and this is a very, very important part of your whole modeling. Yeah. How you can how to prepare your data, how to make it ready for modeling. Yeah. And this is where your, you know, how good you are as a data scientist or as a data analyst comes in. Or how much you can, how easily you can make that. And there are a lot of decisions which you have to take during data manipulation. So there will be missing data. You know, not every data will be available to you. So what do you do? How do you replace the data which is missing? Do you replace the whole you know, row altogether? Let's say there's one parameter which is missing, or do you replace it with some other value? Or do you delete the whole thing altogether? So these are decisions which might affect or impact the output you are getting, you know, or how good your model is fitting. So data manipulation we will look into. Okay. Sorry, 12, I missed 11. So we will also look into these topics briefly, not going into depth. Yeah, one is infographics, business strategy models, data mining, other techniques in data mining like support vector machine and decision tree, neural nets. So we will briefly know what these things mean, but maybe not go into a whole lot of depth. Web analytics, social media analytics, yes. Some of you may already have some exposure to it, do you? Yeah, has anybody worked on any kind of web analytics or social media analytics? Great, Shalvi. Okay. So we will look into a bit of what that means or how you can. Perfect. Okay. And social network analysis, right? We might look into a little bit about network analysis also. What we will learn, what we might learn, and what we may not learn, right? So advanced R coding, R is a 4GL or fourth generation language which has a lot of advanced coding facilities, and you are welcome to, you know, go in depth and ask me questions if you want to do advanced coding, but we may not in the program go into a whole lot of depth in advanced coding. We won't go very deep into any particular domain. We will try to talk about the main domains where data analytics is used, but not go in depth into any of these. Big data and Hadoop, you have a, I don't know why it's moving by itself. Big data and Hadoop, you have a separate course for that. We won't be talking about big data. Advanced statistical concepts and theory, we will not be looking into. Okay, Shushant, you need insights and books that's good for advanced stuff, means all of this stuff or any specific thing which you are interested in? Advanced R. Yeah, so in the next slide, I'll talk about. Yes, I will email you some books and links for advanced stuff. We'll also discuss some of the places online where you can get help in R. Yeah. And, you know, there are a couple of courses in Coursera. Are you aware of Coursera? Okay. So, you know, you want web intelligence and big data model. Okay, so what you can do is maybe just shoot me an email. Yeah, you probably know my, you know, you must be having my email address. I can't type in here. So bidisha.s@edureka.in. send you my email address. Just you know, each one of you may have different requirements in the advanced space, so you can send me a email and I will get back to you on where you can get the material. So Coursera, yes, Sushant, you have done a course in Coursera, is it? Perfect, you have done the R course? Okay, so Coursera also has a very nice course on R, and I will be giving you those links. And it covers a lot of advanced programming techniques as an R. Okay? Yeah, I think it is from, yeah, I will go into that. Let me just give me a little time. I have a slide where I will share with you all the courses which you can do in R, in Coursera, and shoot me an email in case, you know, I'll also do my little research and give you a comprehensive list. Okay. So this is, this slide tells you what is the course methodology. So you are already aware, it's a 6-week course, 2 days, 2 hours. You have some quizzes in class sometimes. Then you have case studies, question answers, class participation which you all are doing. There will be a group project and there will be a final exam. And there's a pass criteria, of course, if you have to score above 65% to get a certificate. Okay? Alright. Okay, so would you like to take a break now? Before we go into details, yeah. So let's take a 5-minute break. Yeah, and I'll see you back in 5 minutes. Yeah, alright. Okay. Shall we start? Great. So we've already covered these, right? What is business analytics? What are the problems which we are trying to solve? What are the tools which can be used? How are businesses solving these problems? How is data analytics playing a role? Yeah, and you must be aware that a lot of the work happens through Excel and spreadsheets, right? But it has its limitations, yeah? Right? So one of the limitations is, of course, the amount of data. Spreadsheets can only handle a certain amount of data. And, you know, that is where you start relying on tools like R and SAS, etc., where Excel is no longer able to address huge volumes of data, and advanced techniques of statistical analysis also. Though Excel does cover a lot of analysis techniques in its data analysis pack, etc., there are, of course, a lot of limitations. So, okay. So now moving on. What is business analytics? So what kind of problems does it solve? You know all this. History of business analytics, we have covered that. Different kinds of business analytics, we have covered that also. Different kinds of techniques. What is R? What is SAS? Right? SAS has been what predominantly have been the tool which people have used for business analytics. But today R is gaining more and more popularity. So how are they different? So this part we will look into. So before we go into what are the differences between SAS and R and what are the advantages one has over the other, we need to know a little bit about R, okay? A little bit about the history of the language, what it does. So we will get into more and more into deep into R from this point. So moving on, yeah, so this is a link, rproject.org, where you can, you know, read up on the evolution of R. I won't spend time in the class getting into it, but how it has evolved from the S language. So R is basically a different implementation of S. S was created at Bell Laboratories and R was, I think, created at University of Auckland. So you can go into that and see how it has evolved. So this is a link which will tell you about the history of R, rproject.org. It's open source, it is free, it is very easy, widely recognized, means it can be used along with a lot of tools, a lot of different tools. We will look into the official website of R, R installation. Let me move ahead. So corporate usage of R. Domains and companies. So which are the domains which are using R? Mainly the domains who are doing a lot of analytics. We already covered that, you know, BFSI, retail. These are some of the standard domains where R is used. And companies which are, you know, R is, of course, like as I said, an open source tool and a framework. But there are different companies which are making R more and more easily available by integrating it with other products. So these may be existing products in statistical modeling with which R is being integrated. Like SAS integrates with R, and then you have Tableau, which in its latest version allows you to integrate with R. And then there are standalone tools which have been created on R alone. Like, you know, we briefly spoke about RStudio and Revolutionary R. So these are all different softwares which are being used, which have been created by companies for making, for increasing the usability of R as a language and a platform. Okay. So yeah, we just spoke about some of the companies which are developing R products. So RStudio is an R product which gives you a you know, good interface, a good user interface for doing our program. Revolution Analytics is another product which allows, so even R, I would say, has some data limitations by itself because it does the whole data modeling and running on RAM, you know. So Revolution Analytics provides a way to manage that, where you can work with bigger volumes of data using R programming. And though R is free and open source, Revolution Analytics, I believe, is not free. You know, it has an enterprise license which you have to pay for. Okay. Okay, do you know that SAP uses R for analyzing its HANA database? So like we said, that it is, you know, look at the breadth of how R is being used. So you can now embed R core in SAP for your statistical modeling. So all these tools which are using some kind of statistical modeling are looking for ways to integrate with R or connect with R to enhance its statistical capabilities. Because R just offers so many packages, so much graphical utilities, and it is free of cost, you know. So it is in the interest of different software or different product developers and software product developers to you know, increase the usage of R. So this is, you can look, go to this link, help.sap.com, and see how SAP is using R for in its HANA database. Okay, SAS Institute. Yeah, so one would think that SAS is a direct competitor of R, because R is you know, gaining so much popularity over this few years. But as we know that in SAS, a lot of the packages you have to pay for. So just you know, if it's not working, just go and search. Yeah, I'll just test. I think there are some. Okay. Yeah, you're right. It's not working. What I would typically do is, so you can help.sap.com. Yeah, so there would be some, this is one PDF file where you will get information. You will also get it in setting up guide if you really want to. Yes, I'll just send you the link. Yeah. So you can go into each of these contents and find out how R and SAP integrates. Yeah, so then like I said, in SAS, a lot of the things which you have to pay for separately in terms of buying SAS packages, you can, you know, which can be done using R for free. So SAS is also looking at R as an opportunity and finding means where you can invoke R functions through SAS, right? Okay. So you can look at this link to see how SAS is working with R. Then Teradata is also using R for analytics. These are just some of the examples. All these links are provided, and these material is already available in LMS. You know? So you can just download them, and if you are interested in any specific tool and how it is working with R, so you can go to that link and read up more. So this is just to give you an overview of the breadth of usage of R. Since you're going to be experts in R, we need to know how much, you know, what are the places where R is being used. IBM uses and teaches R for high-end analytics. And so does a lot of other companies. You know, today R is one of the primary skills which you are asked when you put in, when you say you are a data scientist. That is the first question which probably can be expected to hear. And you know, one of the reasons is often when we do data analysis, the client may not be in a position to invest in some very high-end expensive statistical product, right? So sometimes it is a requirement from the client side that, you know, you use something which can be implemented free of cost or with no, you know, which is free. So that is where, from the business, there is a lot of thrust to use R. Also because it's open source and can easily be connected with existing software, existing data sources very easily. Okay, so what are the domains? This we have already covered: telecom, pharma, financial services, life sciences, right? Clients of R, yeah, almost anyone you can look at. So, and it's, and this is by no means an exhaustive list. Yes, Shalini, you have a question? When will this material be available in LMS? I believe it's already available. Yeah, it should already be available once you log on to LMS. But in case you have, if you're not able to, okay, maybe you have to send an email to, you know, our coordinator should be able to help. Fine, Shalini, I'll get that resolved. So once the course gets over, you should be able to get it in LMS. I will talk to the people in charge of the content. Sure, I'll do that. Is there a link? No, there is no link. If you go to LMS, you will see the content divided module-wise. So on your module, like module 1, you will be able to get the deck for today's class. Not. So when you go to LMS, do you see something like this? Yeah, do you see something like LMS, and then there is a section called Module 1. Yeah. I'll have somebody send you a detailed email with the instructions. Can others see? Are others able to find it in LMS? Or is this a common problem, or only Shalini is facing it? Okay. Right, so Shalini, Rajat, Ranjit, everyone is able to see it. Yeah, so really it is available, you know. Shivakumar is also able to see. So yeah, so probably Harani, maybe you are facing a specific problem, or maybe you are not going to the right place. So we'll take it offline, we'll take it separately. Basically, once you log on to EduReka and then you go to the LMS, you should be able to see it under Module 1. Okay, so now comparing R, so is it all good or there are some disadvantages in R? So R is open source, it has a lot of packages, these are all the good things about R. Yeah, it can be customized, it has very good graphics which is available free, you know, available to you free of cost. It has UI to help you, you know, start using R very easily. It can connect to many databases and data types. Yeah, these are the advantages which we discussed, but it does have a steep learning curve. It is not as easy as a lot of other tools. There are a lot of packages, you know, it's, you might get your lost in the middle of all that. So you need to know what you are doing, what are the different ways to do it in R, and why to choose one over the other. Yeah, by default stores memory in RAM, and we discussed this, right? Like it loads the data onto RAM and works. So depending on your RAM, that might become a limitation. If you have a, if you don't have a high capacity RAM, you may not be, you may have a, may have to work with smaller data sets. Yes, you do need good programming skills, and what else? Customization needs command line. You need to use which package to use. Yeah, so these are not really, I wouldn't say these are really disadvantages, but yeah, you need to work your way around these. Okay. Yes, we already covered the slide. Yeah, so this is another link, R4Stats. It's a very good link, in fact. If you go to r4stats.com, yeah, so here you get to see what are the different, you know, how R is being used in different, along with different softwares, and you know, a lot of analysis on which software being used, which are the tools in the market, players in the market, what has been the trend over the years in terms of, you know, jobs, yes, but also in terms of usage of R, etc. Yeah, so go through this. You know, this is also something which has some interesting insights. And if you look at this graph over here, you can see that this is how you see, like, you know, SPSS, SAS, Tata, these are the main tools, software modeling tools, which has been popular, and how R has grown, you know, really steep over the years. Okay, so any questions till now, or we will move into, you know, installation of R. Any questions? Okay. So, do you all have R installed on your machines? Yes or no? Yes? Okay, great. Okay, some of you have not. So, yeah, so for those who have already installed it, this may be a repetition, but for those who have not, we need to install R before we proceed. Okay, so Anirudh, you have a question. Yes? Yes, Anirudh? You can type in the question, any specific. Okay, so a few questions here. Okay, Shushant is asking, any specific computer configuration needed? No. You can install R on any computer, Mac or Windows, but if you, the greater RAM you have, the better performance you will get. Will the course cover using external files? And with the external files means what? Like, you mean Excel files or CSV files or any particular file format? Are you, so what is your question, Anirudh? RAM limitations or what, or external files? DB tables as input? We can talk about it, we can cover it briefly, but mostly we will work with CSVs or spreadsheets. Yeah, external files for sure. We will talk about how you can import data from, let's say, a CSV file or a spreadsheet, which is an external file. But yeah, tables, I can tell you how you can connect to different data sources. But since all of us may not have the infrastructure to connect to the same kind of a data source, which may be an SQL Server database or something, we will stick to external files for our program here. But if you want to connect to a specific data source, again, shoot me an email. I will tell you what package to use and how you can do that. Yeah, we will also talk about how to save data in external files. No problem. Very simple, actually. Course assignment, if you were to use Oracle R rather than open source version, should be fine. I don't see a problem, Rajat, with doing that. You can use Oracle R. But why don't you use, you know, open source version of R? Because, you know, it will give you the flexibility and the, to use R with almost anything. So if you have Oracle R, fine, you can do it in Oracle R, but go ahead and install, I would suggest, you know, recommend that you install the open source version and work on it. Because I'm sure there will be some changes made to the Oracle R version. Yeah. So if you have installed R, well and good. If you have not installed R, you can go to this link. Yeah. cran.rproject.org. Yeah, and there you will see a few links. Download R for Linux, download R for Mac. Are you all using Windows machine or anyone is using a Mac or Linux? Windows. Perfect. So then you need to click on the third link. Okay. Some of you are using Mac and Linux. Poor guy. Yeah, even I use Windows. In fact, I have Windows on a Mac. Windows installed on a Mac. So you can use anything, basically. You know, should not if you be a problem. I personally have not worked on Linux, but I've worked on Mac and Windows. But you should not face any problem. Yeah. So download R. Can you all click, those of you who don't have R, can you click on the package, on the link, which is appropriate for you, whether it's Linux or Mac or Windows? And it will take you to the installation process. If you have any problems, just let me know. So once you have R installed and you run R, you should see a console like this. If you can see my screen, you will see the R console like this. So once you get there, just tell me that you are done. Great. Great, Gavish. Some of you already are there. Anirudh, you are also there. Great. Okay, anyone who is not there? Okay, Shalini, we'll wait for you. Great. Yeah, so it will take a few minutes. And once you have finished downloading it, you can open up the console. So once you've installed R, then we'll see how we can install packages, update packages, etc. Great. So there is also something called the R Studio, right? So we will start with R for now, but you know, after the program is in your spare time, you can go and install R Studio. So from tomorrow when we start working, you can select, you can make a choice whether you want to work on R or you want to work on R Studio. Okay, so R Studio will look something like this. This is like, okay, so you have a choice of using R or R Studio. Let's start with R today, and then you need to have R in order to install R Studio, and that is also free. So RStudio has a better GUI, you know, and a lot of menu-driven options where you have to write code in R. It is menu-driven in RStudio. Help is, you know, like you can see the help in a separate window. You can see all your packages in a window. You can see everything in one place, your plots, your packages, help. Plus, you have a lot of menu-driven options. So it has definitely some advantages over R console. I find it more comfortable using RStudio. But whatever code or whatever command you use in R will work same in RStudio. So there is actually no difference. Even in this class, some of you are using R, some of you are using RStudio. There should be no problem. So moving on, so once you have installed R, if you have any problems with installing R, let me know, but it's usually very smooth. So once you have installed R, for RStudio, I will, you know, just Google it. RStudio. So if to install it from here. Okay. So there is a desktop version of RStudio, which is the one which you download. Yeah, but like I said, you can comfortably continue working with R console. Okay. Alright. So R and R packages. Yeah, packages are also same for both. There's no difference. It's the same R which you are doing in R as well as RStudio, just that the UI is different and the experience is different as a user. Okay, so this is the list of, this is installation of packages. So everything in R is a package. Okay, so if you want to install some package, let's say I want to install, okay, so now I am in the R console and I want to install a package. So how do I, there is a link called packages. I can say install package. Yeah, did you all follow me with that? So you go to packages and say install package. So when you say install package, it will open up a window for you to select the CRAN mirror. So you can basically choose any, let's say choose India. That's basically the site from where they will download the package. Okay, so these are all the different packages in R, and you don't need to know what each of one of them means. No one knows. I wouldn't say no one knows, but it's difficult for any one person to know all of these. But let's say I want to download A3 package. Okay, so I just select A3 and I click OK. It will install that package on my machine, okay, or let's say any other package. See, I want to install ABT. So when I say OK, it is going to install that package on my machine and any other dependencies. So some packages might have some other packages as dependencies. So it will install all the packages that are necessary to install that one package which you are installing. Right? So you can install the package through the packages install package, right? But before you use the package, you have to then load the package. So you have a load package option. Are you with me? Okay, so just like you did install, you went to packages and did install package, you can also do install dot packages, and let's say we select, we saw a package called A3, right? So this is the command I can write, type onto the console, that install dot packages A3. So if you have selected a CRAN mirror, well and good, otherwise this will also do the same thing. Whatever that menu option was doing, it will also prompt for a CRAN mirror site if you have not already selected it, and it will install all the package which you have specified and any dependencies. So I wanted to install A3. It is also installed XTML and pbapply because these are two packages which A3 has dependencies on. Okay. Now before I want to use before I can use A3, I have to go to packages load package. So when I do packages load package, I get to see only those packages which I have already installed. Okay, so this is a subset of all that list which we had seen in the previous window. Right? So since I have now installed A3, I can say OK. So it will load A3. Right? Or there is a package, there is a command called library. So instead of writing load package A3, I mean going through the menu, I could have done library A3. I could have done this also. Okay. All right. So that would do the same thing. So library A3 would have loaded, done the same thing what I did by going to packages and load package. Clear till now? Anyone facing any problems? Excellent. So each of these, you know, let's say I was talking about, so I've opened the R studio, but you can also do it in R. So if I look at packages, let's say car. Do we need to load packages every time? Yeah, every time. Every time you open your console, you need to load the package which you are going to use. You don't need to install it every time. Once you have installed it, it is installed, but you have to load it every time. Okay, Shalini? Yeah. So, so here in this help, you can just to look, click on see NAR Studio. You can click on this packages link here, and it will give you all the packages which you have. Okay, and then if you click on any, like we just used cars, if you use a car, it will tell you what are the different functions which is there in that package. So I can see, so for let's say association rules we were talking about, so there is a package called A rules. Yeah, so if I look at the A rules package, so it has all these methods for association. And yeah, we will go into some of the details over time. So A3 is another package. So let's see, A3. So now if I look at packages, I should be able to see A3. I don't know why A3 is not coming here. Maybe I can just or you can just look for it in our help, you know. Yeah, I installed it after I had opened RStudio. Yeah. So it is A3 is a package which helps you for building predictive models. So this is your A3 package. So if you have loaded, so it has a lot of functions for, you know, generating data, running some regressions, doing some predictions. So this is a standard package which is used for predictive models. We will not go into the details of each function and what it does right now, but I chose A3 because it was one of the topmost packages and starting with A. So if you want to use A for any regression modeling or for prediction, then we can talk about A3 separately on what all it does. No, so you have to, there is no metric on what package to use when. So that is one of the challenges in R which I had discussed. So, yeah, there is a way to search for a particular package that may contain your needed function. Sure, that is there. But there is no direct way to know that, you know, which, you want to do something, so which package, which function you need to call. A lot of it comes with experience. And help plays a big role over here. Okay, so let's say I want to use a function called, or let's say, you know, like ANOVA. Okay, so I want to use ANOVA. So if I say ?ANOVA, it will give you the whole help for the ANOVA function, including what package it is available in. Alright, so whether it's in RStudio or in R, I'm coming to your question, Gabish, but whether it's in RStudio or in R, if you just do ?, any function, ?plot, yeah, so it will open up the help for you. ?, is the way for plotting, for finding help on anything. So here I did plot, so it has taken me to the plot function. So in RStudio, I can do the same thing. It gives me the same help. Except that in RStudio there is a dedicated window for help and it comes right in the same screen. Okay. Alright, so let me now look at the questions. Yeah, package that contains your needed function. So let's say you want to search for something which is not there in this package. What would be an example? So, you know, if it is not available in this package, then you can do ?? So when it is not available, if it says that, you know, if you said it ?ANOVA and it told you that, you know, sorry, we are not able to find any function called ANOVA, then you try ?ANOVA. Okay, in which case it will take you to that package. So ?, function will search for the packages which are already there, and ?, will take you to, will search across all the functions. Yeah. Okay. Now let me look at the questions. What is there a way to search for a particular? I've already replied. For example, I see regression you can do with A3, but you also have a package with Regar which also do. And that's exactly what I'm saying, Gabish. You have number of you know, ways in which you can do regression. So there is a REGR package, there is an LM function which you can use for linear regression. Yeah. So you have multiple ways and each one of them has their positives, negatives, when one is to be used, when something else to be used. You can play around with it and see. So that is one of the judgments which you need to make as a programmer. Yeah, so that is where the help comes to use. So you look at all the regression functions, maybe you do, and you read through what each one of them does, and then you choose the function which is appropriate for your data and your model. There is no off-the-shelf answer, you know, that this is the better function, use that. I can't tell you that. There is a reason all these packages and all these different functions have been created, and there are some differences among each one of those. Yeah, but in a specific case, I will be able to tell you why we should use one and not another. So Shivakumar, what happened? Meta-analysis. Package, what it means? Package is a group of functions. Yeah? So, and they are defined by a purpose it serves. So, A3 is a package which we know, which contains a group of functions which is related to regression. Yeah? Similarly, there is a function which may be only about UI. There is a package which contains a lot of functions on plotting. It is nothing but a group of functions. R has a lot of functions which are divided into different groups, and each group is a package. Yeah, so just like methods in Java and class, right? So if you group a lot of methods together and you call it a package, you know, it is a package in Java, right? Shushant? So similarly, there is a package in R, yeah. So all these functions are written, compiled for you. Once you load the package, you can... Once you install the package, load the package, you can call the function. But the same function is spread across packages, for functions are not unique for a package. Right, they are not unique for a package. Because Gavish, today if you want, you can create your own package. Yeah. So if you feel you want to do some kind of a data modeling for which a package doesn't exist, you can come up with your own package and create it. That is the reason why you would have created it, right? Because it's not already, what you need is exactly not there in the existing packages. So then one more package gets created. Yeah? Don't worry too much about it. So we will start with using some of the packages, some of the functions. And like I said, there is nobody who knows that all the packages and all the functions which are under the sky. That is where help comes to use. Try it. If you want to run a regression using one function in one package, use that. Use it in another function in another package, do that. See the differences. See why this is different from that. And that is the best way you can make out the different functions. Which one to use well. Okay? Alright. So, we have already done this installing packages. Let's move on and see what is the next thing which we should do today. So this is your list of packages which we did. Installing packages, we have done that. Yeah. So CRAN mirror sites containing all packages. So once you have installed packages, they are loaded on your machine. It contains all your installed packages. And library package actually loads that package on your session. This we have already covered. You can do it through the menu. You can do it by writing the command line, writing the command in your console. Okay. So now, before we end today's session, we will just get a little more familiar with the R console. Yeah. So you know, if you look at the R console, you can use it like for basic calculations, you can use it, you know. So you can just start with anything. You can type 2 plus 3, it will give you 5, yeah. So you can do any kind of calculation, multiplication. So I've multiplied 78 by 4. So you can do division. You can do, it looks more like a Python console. Yes, Shushant. If you're comfortable with Python, a lot of it will be familiar. Yeah, but Python, I would say, but again, there are differences, you know. There are places where R scores over Python in the kind of functions and data analytics which it can do. Python we use more for, is more inclined for text mining kind of analytics, where R has more, you know, statistical modeling. R has more functions on that. Yeah. So console-wise, if you're comfortable with the Python console, you'll find this familiar. okay. So you can do anything, you know, to the power, this is square. So you can do 10 square, yeah. So these are the, so, you know, after we wind up today's session, you spend some time on the R console, write your own, just try to do simple calculations, so you'll get familiar with the console, you know. Once you have done simple calculations, you can assign values. So those of you are little familiar with programming, so I can say A, 2, B, 5, and I can say C is A plus B. That will give me. So what it has done is it has assigned 2 to the A, B to the variable B. It has calculated the sum of A plus B and put it in C. And now when I write C, it is printing C out for me, right? So this is a simple thing which we can do. So now let us say I want to have a list of numbers. So I can say my list, or I can put it as anywhere, x. Okay, C is a command which tells me that, okay, which tells R that I am now going to enter a number of values. Okay, so let's say I put a number of values. Simple values. So this is my x. So now I can do a lot of things, right? I can just, let's say I can just write plot x. If you look at it, it's just plotted all these values. It has plotted 2, 5, 7, 4 like this. Yeah? Simple? Okay. Then it can do, let's say I want to, I'm not happy with these circles, you know. So I want to see how you can put a line. I want a line connecting all these points. So let me see if the plot function can do that. So since I am not sure how to do it, I do question mark plot. Yeah. So in question mark plot, you can give your x coordinate, you can give your y coordinate, and here there is something called type, which tells me, you know, whether it should be a point or a line or both, etc. So let's try that, you know, let's say plot x type equal to L and see what it has done is it has created a line joining all these points. Shushant, what do you mean by like tuple? Like you mean the whole list of values is a tuple. Yeah, so the set of values I have given is a tuple. Yeah, you can call it a tuple. It's just an array. It's just a vector of that many values, you know, 12 or 13 values. So right now, since I don't have a whole data set, the term tuple wouldn't make that much sense because all I have given is a set of numbers, right? But it could very much be a tuple. And since I am giving a whole data set, then I can pick up each row and plot each row, where each row will be a tuple. Yeah, Shalini, how is the plot function working? That is what R takes care of you, because they are already, the plot function exists in R. You just have to invoke the function, give the parameters, and it will generate. Yeah, it supports multidimensional arrays also. They are called matrices. Okay, so let's say I did B. B means both line and a point. So it's not only joins, but it also shows the points in a circle. And then you can do a lot of things, you know, you can do, if you look at the help, there is a title for x-axis, if you want to put a title for y-axis, what is the value of x and y here? Nothing. I just created an array of these numbers. So y, it has just, y over here just means the index of each value of x. So if you see, they've created y as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So if I wanted to create a y, let's say I want to create a y which is know, let's say it's just a double of this, let's say. You can start with, it didn't get y value, Sushant, it just plotted the x. So the y axis is basically, you know, it doesn't, it has not, so you can plot one variable against another variable, which we call a scatter plot, or you can just plot one variable, right? So I have 10 numbers, 1 to 10, I can just plot that. Are you getting this? So let's say y is 1, 2, 3, okay, now if I have to give 1 to 10, there is a way to do it. 1 is to 10. So y is 1 to 10. Okay. Forget about x and y. So x over here, I just have an array of numbers. Yeah. So if I want to just plot y, what will it do? It will plot a line. Make sense? Is this clear? Right, so I am just plotting the set of 10 numbers. So I have put a set of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So if you look at my command, y arrow c1 is to 10, it gives this number 1 through 10. These 10 numbers is assigns it to y. Okay, and once I plot this, it just plots these 10 numbers. So it's only plotting y. Similarly, if I plot x, now x is not a straight, you know, 1 through 10. It is what how I have defined it, 2, 5, 7, 4. So it has some ups and downs. So if I plot x, this is how it looks. Shalini, is it clear? It is just a group of numbers, a set of numbers. Is it clear to all? So what I showed you here is just how you can assign a variable one number, or you can assign index is a number. It is like, you know, the first value of x is 2 has index 1. The second value of x is 5, it has index 2. It is the row number or the, you know, where the position at which it comes. Make sense? Yeah. So now if I wanted to plot x with y, now look at this. Okay, now it doesn't have the same units because I have 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. So if I had given the same number of variables, okay, now what it is doing is, now it is plotting y against x. I don't want. So that time I was just plotting the value of x or just the value of y. Now I am saying, okay, for each value x2, y is 1. For x5, y is 2. Yeah. This is a very weird plot, but it just shows how x and y are related. So we just did one function here, plot. We just saw how in the R console you can, you know, put in different commands and do certain calculations, how you can assign values to a variable and how you can assign a vector or a set of numbers to a variable and plot it. Okay. So do, if you do a little bit more, you know, spend some more time on the R console, writing some functions or, you know, setting some variables, you will become comfortable. It is very easy. So once you spend some time today with these, then tomorrow we can do some more work like writing our own functions, you know, knowing how to create a function or doing a for loop. These things we can do tomorrow. Okay. All right. So you have a good Saturday, good weekend And I'll see you all tomorrow at the same time.